The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
But let's pray. Father, we just thank you for this day, for this time, and that we're crossing a threshold of new things and the time of blessing and a season of blessing. And we would just ask that each and every one of us would receive all that you want to have for us, and that we would increase our capacity to live for you and serve you all the days of our life. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. We have an interesting development, and we announced it Tuesday. We have an opportunity for a weekly program on ISN. That's It's Supernatural Network. It's a network that Sid Ross is doing. And we have, it's a wonderful opportunity, but we needed to upgrade our system. This one's fine, but to meet the qualifications, we're basically going to get all new equipment, and that team room is going to become basically a studio. We'll get the backdrop, the lighting, and the cameras. And we're working with this company out of California, and it's going to be 3 cameras. So it's interesting. It's get you both the side views change and everything. But anyway, we made this announcement Tuesday, and much to my pleasure and surprise, you streamers have responded, as well as people in the church. And we're probably halfway there or better already, just since Tuesday, and hardly anybody even knew about it. And so I just wanted to encourage people. And so we thought that we have a special button on our website. It's a link. It's actually a link. And for any donation of $20 or more, because everything helps when you're buying it. When you're a church of 50 people, $20 is a big deal. But any donation of $20 or more, I think there's also a $5 shipping charge, We're giving 2 children's books. These are each normally sold at $29 a piece, and it's 2 2-in-1. These are 2 books in one. This is the first children's book. You see them over there. We have them separate, and we have the 2-in-1s. This is the first 2 books together in one book, and 2 of these. That's like $58 if you donate $20 or more plus $5 shipping. Does this sound like a commercial? It's going toward television equipment. And if you don't want the 2 children's books, you say, I don't have any children, then we have The Power of Peace. This was the series that was done. One of the programs on Sid Roth was on The Power of Peace. Destiny Image is currently turning our material into a book, probably be out December of this year. We have another book coming out in May 20th. But the one on peace, they contacted us when we did a Sid Ross program and said, I notice you don't have a book on that piece, but we have a journal and the CD set. And they have actually, this is only a set of 4. They have 18 messages that they are going to turn into a book on supernatural peace. We have in their CD, Sar Shalom, Supernatural Peace, The Will of God is a River, that, et cetera, Power of Peace, and all of those. They've transcribed them, and they're placing them in an order that Jennifer and I have designated as kind of a structure. So we're excited about that. But in the meantime, a weekly half-hour program is what we're shooting for, and that room will be it. And so I think twice in 38 years I ever asked for money, and 2 of them since I've been here. The good news is we're getting free airtime, but our product, because Sid Roth's a real stickler for not asking for money on the air, because Christian programming's done that for a long time. But they will sell products, so much of our product will be part of an opportunity to teach in their school as well. And so our product will get better distribution that way. We've had people fly in from around the world to take module one, module two, module three. But eventually we could even be doing that on the TV, where people could actually not have to fly here and could take it, take the courses. And that would be all five of our modules. That up until now, we won't sell the modules. The modules have to be done here where I know it's caught. It's kind of like when they taught on prophecy, they wanted you to actually prophesy. Well, that's why we're kind of a stickler with the modules. We want you to actually know that you're doing, that you're literally practicing the presence. You're literally getting life-changing experience and transformation. So anyway, if you're watching by Ustream, we really appreciate you. Very loyal people and very giving people financially. And so God really blessed the fact that he told us to expand the family of God much larger than this local congregation. As a matter of fact, on any given time, there's probably more people watching the program than we have in the building. And there are places around the world that are replicating and duplicating our material, and their groups are much bigger than we are ourselves. So that's exciting. That's to me, that was my heart, to help as many people as possible. That's the passion. And so I wanted to announce something that else that happened. God had spoken to some private things to Jennifer and I about relationship, and I think we shared this in the previous week. And two of those relationships that God spoke to us when we didn't have a relationship was Sid Roth Ministries and Morningstar. Not that you can't have more relationships than that. But in that time, he spoke that privately. He says you're to behave as a neighbor. And I thought that was an interesting thing. So later, Jennifer got asked for the Oak Initiative and stuff. And I said, we're not taking an honorarium or anything from either Morningstar or nothing from Sid Roth. And we would offer ourselves as a resource. And without promoting or marketing that, I'm saying this stuff publicly now because it's after the fact. And in light of all that, it has developed, it's continuing to develop relationally. And all of a sudden, Two weeks ago, we get Michael sends me an email, and he said, now look, you're not normally on my radar. I don't usually pray for you people. I'm from another church. And we're going to this morning have Michael share his revelation. Michael, you want to come on up? Then Jennifer's going to share something I've been waiting for a long time, and then I'm going to sum it up if I'm not busy crying.
Holy Spirit, I thank you. You're here in power already. You bless this congregation. And I'm a prophetic intercessor. And if you don't know what that means, it just means you tune in and you see things in the Holy Spirit, and then you bless people based on what you see. And so I'm kind of wired that way. I'm a watchman. And so I regularly kind of just spend time in his presence and see what he's saying so I can agree with what the Father's saying. About a week ago, I was in the Spirit, and I see really clearly Pastor Dennis and Dr. Jen's faces in front of me, and I knew that the Holy Spirit had something to say because they haven't normally been on my radar. You know, I've been really focused on birthing what God's doing. You know, I'm planted at CSCL and at Morningstar right now, so I've kind of had laser focus on that. I think probably one reason the Lord showed me their faces is because we are neighbors and we're connected. And it's kind of like we're all co-laborers together in this. So I'm just going to read some of what I saw and then share some of what we talked about on the phone. Anyways, I saw a large door open over this fellowship, and it was right there. I hadn't been to this fellowship yet, but that, you know, that's where it was. A large door opened over the fellowship, and when it opened, the whole sanctuary was filled with pure white light. And if you're wondering what pure white light is, it's two things. It's the living Christ, and it's the light of the kingdom, the light that makes everything visible, the light of the kingdom of heaven. But this was a door of awakening. And within the light, I could hear angels' voices, brilliant arrays of color and glory, and a warm spring wind that carried both rain and the scent of dew on it. And the wind shook silver wind chimes that released a song of awakening that brought more angels. And it was the sound of the bride making herself ready. That's Revelation. If you look at Revelation 21, it gives you a prophetic picture of everything I just said, really. And as soon as the door opened, the whole room became filled with a manifestation of great glory and love. It was literally heaven on earth. The room I saw became a garden of delights in which the Father was pleased to walk with each one of his children in the cool of the day. As glorious as everything smelled and sounded and looked, it was the total love of the Father. The total love of the Father that actually caused the garden to grow. It became filled with sweet flowers and fragrances and fruit. And by the way, on the same day, you know, I'm not putting in a plug for Lowe's, but I've been wanting fruit trees, and they had them on sale for $10, and I got 3 apple and 2 peach. So there's your fruitfulness. I also received this on the day that daylight savings time happened. And so I felt like the Lord said that you were in a time of springing forward. The Lord says now is the time for your ministry and your fellowship to spring forward, and you are coming into a season of accelerated blessing. You've done much plowing and sown much seed. However, the season is here when the Father is going to bless all that you have done with the warm spring wind and rain from heaven. Do I need to point out the weather today? I also saw your hearts wondering if this season would end, but every time you had this thought, the warm spring wind would actually increase. This is because the wind is the wind of his love and glory, and now is the appointed time to awaken the bride. Before I share some of the stuff on the back here, I want to connect this to a prophetic experience I had about 15 years ago, back when I was a pizza delivery guy. You know, I went and dropped off a couple sheet pizzas at a corporate office park. I come out, and I see an angel standing outside the door, crying. And as soon as I saw him, I felt all of his emotion, the love, the joy, the longing. And I asked him, why are you crying? And he almost couldn't get the words out. He said, because the bride is making herself ready. And then I looked up and I saw like a window open in heaven, and there was this wind, and it had all these raindrops and the scent of dew on it, and it was making these silver wind chimes clink and sing, and it would bring multitudes of angels, the sound of the bride awakening. And it's the sound of spring as well, because in spring, everything that was dormant comes to life. Everything that has been dormant in you and in everyone in this fellowship is about to spring up in new life. Everything that was dormant is about to spring up in new life. Everything that was dormant is about to spring up to new life. The song of the bride is now awakening over this place. And you are going to sing together. Just like when the light, the Lamb who is the light at the center of the New Jerusalem comes, every crystal in that building is lit up. And each one has a different frequency, a different song. But together there's a harmony that's released, and it's the harmony of perfect love and the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. And that's what is being released here. So, anyways, this wind was coming, and these multitudes of angels, and then this beautiful white train which was like this bridal garment. And the train, it like began in heaven, but then it was resting on the earth. Because that's what he's releasing now, that we're connecting heaven with earth. So I also saw Pastor Jason, and in the vision there was like a swirling around him, like the waters were being stirred, and he was holding a brass nozzle, which was also a blast nozzle of the anointing, and there was a trumpet blast on him. And that swirling, the Lord has repeatedly spoken to me through swirling. It's from Song of Solomon, the dance of Mahanaim, which is the dance of two camps. It's like two camps dancing together. Those two camps are the camp of men and the camp of angels. It is the intertwining of the heavenly and earthly realms in the kingdom, the New Jerusalem on the earth. But there's an increase of authority, of prophetic authority on that. A few more things. It's hard to sometimes sort it out here. Okay, so anyways, the same day, so this happened in the morning. I send the email, and I'm running late for a 5K race at CSCL because the race was also beginning this morning, that morning. And I run out with my boys, and I'm locked out of the house. And, you know, I swore my neighbor gave the key back to me. I go and knock once and no answer, and I'm getting frustrated, call my wife. She's getting ready to leave. And I pray. I should have done that to start with. And I go and knock again, and he answers, and he has the key. So there's a race, an accelerated blessing, an acceleration this fellowship is about to walk into, but your neighbors are the key to entering into that, right? So the other thing I saw was that Pastor Dennis and Dr. Jen are the keystone to a new threshold. And I saw a threshold made out of Jerusalem stone, which, you know, is beautiful. It has all those different colors. But that you're a key stone in what is about to unfold. A key stone. A key stone. Sorry, sometimes I can't help myself. I got to repeat it if it sounds good. for crossing into the threshing floor. So the threshing floor, that's where you sort through things and you burn out. That's where the wood, hay, and stubble is burned out of the body. And the gold, silver, and costly stones that are what the New Jerusalem's made out of, the bride that made herself ready, are purified. In that threshing floor where the fire comes, that is what we're eventually what becomes the Holy of Holies. So two more things quickly. So also, as a ministry and as a fellowship, you've removed stones from the womb of the church. So in Bible times, in order to prevent conception, they would put stones inside the womb of livestock and sometimes even woman to prevent conception. And these are, it would bring barrenness. And so this speaks of removing the hindrances and removing the blockages. But now is the time of conception. It like just like when the angel came and spoke over Mary. I'm just going to read the exact words. The angel said over Mary, and this is what he's saying over this congregation, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God, because he's birthing the living Christ in you. That is the pure white light. That is the inheritance. It's the birthing of all the power of the living Christ in you. That is our inheritance. So I bless you today in the name of the Lord. I bless you as a neighbor. I bless you as a neighbor. And I proclaim that you will come into your full inheritance, that the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and that the full light of the living Christ, the full light of the kingdom of heaven will shine here, that this will be a place where a gateway is opened up, just like in Genesis 28. That word gateway is also, it means portal in Hebrew. And he said, surely the presence of God was in this place, and I wasn't aware of it. And suddenly he saw the angels ascending and descending, and he called it Beth-El, house of God, gateway, portal to heaven. And I proclaim, Lord, a portal over this place, an open door, a gateway over this place. Let the angels of the Lord ascend and descend and accelerate everything that you're doing in this place. Bring the full expression of the kingdom of God and all the powers of the age to come. Let them manifest in this place. In Jesus' name.
I want to tell you a story this morning of a small town in the 1800s, small Scottish town. Into this town, a young orphan girl moved to live with her Aunt Meg, her Aunt Margaret. She's 9 years old, Annie Anderson. A pretty little girl, a blonde-headed little girl, a small girl. And in this town, there was a schoolhouse. The schoolhouse, the one-room schoolhouse for all the children of the town. And this is where Annie would begin to attend school. Let me give you a little background about the atmosphere, the religious atmosphere at this particular time. Their theology was a God of harshness, a God of judgment, one who would come down hard on miserable sinners. This is the message that was preached in the churches. This was the belief that was held by the people in that town. The schoolmaster in this town, his name was Murdoch Mallison. And this is where Annie Anderson entered through the doors of what would become her lion's den. Murdoch Mallison, he believed at this time, as was the general atmosphere and the general belief, that the rod of correction should be used unsparingly on the child. Law was the message of the day. Law was the practice of the day. Murdoch Mallison was not a bad man, but he was a fierce-tempered man. And he believed himself to be an instrument of absolute justice. What is said to be the great commandment of the Old Testament was not what Murdoch Mallison believed, nor what he lived. Micah 6:8, God has shown you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God? Murdoch Mallison loved justice, and he meted it out unsparingly upon his hapless students. Murdoch Mallison ignored mercy. And Murdoch Mallison was a proud man. He did not know God. He did not walk humbly with God. The stone-hearted God of popular theology then was what Murdoch Mallison embodied. And in a sense, for these hapless students, Murdoch Mallison formed the very picture of God in the eyes of these children. A little background on Murdoch Mallison. He had nothing of the childlike in him. He did not understand the mind of a child. He endured great suffering on the physical bodies of these children, as well as great torment in their minds. Murdoch Mallison had not a rod in his classroom, but he did have a whip. And this whip, he had carefully splayed the ends so that they would hurt the most when they hit the skin of a child. He had soaked it in brine and then put it through the fire to make it good and hard. And the custom in his classroom was the mornings were a time of study and memorization. Ah, but then the afternoons. Then the students would come up one by one and be required to recite their memorized lessons from the morning, whether history or literature or catechism or scripture, and they were expected to deliver it perfectly. And if they failed to deliver, they would suffer the sting of the whip around their legs or the handle of the whip beaten against their hands. Well, needless to say, shy little Annie Anderson, already frightened the moment she walked into the door of the schoolhouse, was terrified of Murdoch Mallison. And she shook when she thought about coming up and standing before him and reciting her lessons. Now, Annie was a smart child. She had no memory problem. She was a quick learner. But this first day, she saw what happened to the other students. And she almost could have passed out as she was enforced to take that long walk up the aisle of that schoolroom. And she stood shaking before Murdoch Mallison, and she could not remember her lessons. But this day, perhaps because she was a girl, but perhaps because she was so little, perhaps because somewhere down deep, Murdoch Mallison just couldn't bring himself to physically punish her this first day, this one day, he let her off with it, but never again. And so these students suffered this unsparing rod that was inflicted upon them day after day after day. The students behaved in class, but it was only out of fear. Now, a grandfather and his two orphaned grandsons moved into this little Scottish village. Two little twin boys, older than Annie, but much scrawnier, shorter, and bonier even than little Annie Anderson. And so these Truffy twins, Andrew and Patrick Truffy, they too entered the schoolroom doors. Now, Andrew and Patrick were much worse at schoolwork than Annie, so they had great difficulty. But oddly enough, young Andrew Truffy did not fear Murdoch Mallison, although he suffered greatly at his hands. But he smiled at the man unaccountably and bore the punishment freely and willingly with no attitude in his heart. However, this did not melt the heart of Murdoch Mallison. One time he let Annie off, but nobody ever again. So the day came when, in the quiet time when there should not be the sound but the lessons being learned, nobody ever knew what had happened except the little boys involved. But someone provoked little Andrew so much, and now Murdoch Mallison missed the provocation, but he did not miss this. Andrew hit another boy in the face. Oh, Murdoch Mallison saw that. And so it was as if in one leap he was at the back of that schoolroom. And he grabbed up Andrew Truffy in a fit of rage, and he threw him on the floor. Total silence. No one moved. Nothing happened. Everyone stared at Andrew. Seconds passed. A minute passed. Andrew did not get up off the floor. Murdoch Mallison, in horror, looked down upon the crumpled little bony body on the floor, and his leg was broken. Not only his leg was broken, but his kneecap was crushed. Murdoch Mallison was smitten in his heart, and he knelt down and picked up the little body, walked out of the classroom with the little boy, and carried him to his grandfather's house. Murdoch Mallison began a new practice at this time, day after day after day, with his conscience gnawing away at him. Day after day, month after month, he would go by the grandfather's house and sit by the bedside of the now crippled little boy. Nobody ever knew what happened in that house. Nobody ever knew what Murdoch Mallison said or was said to him. But he was already a changed man. He didn't show the same harshness to the same extent as he had in the past. And the townspeople talked, not about what had happened to Andrew so much, but this strange behavior that was taking place of Murdoch Mallison going and nursemaiding this little boy. Finally, the day came when Murdoch Mallison was up before the students in his classroom, and the wooden door creaked and flung open, and the now three-legged Andrew Truffy came clumping in with his wooden crutch on the wooden floor, and he clumped and he clumped and he clumped and walked up to the desk of Murdoch Mallison and gave him a big smile and then turned and walked back to his desk. From that day on, Murdoch Mallison was haunted by a little boy who followed him wherever he went throughout the town. Murdoch Mallison would hear the clump, clump, clump of that crush on the wooden sidewalk behind him. He'd be in a store and clump, clump, clump. So Andrew Truffy followed him everywhere. And the pride was beginning to be broken. Now, Murdoch Mallison harbored a secret ambition in his heart because, you see, he believed himself to be a great scholar, and he believed himself to be in the possession of great oratorical skills. And he thought it was only just and right. It seems the local clergyman had to leave town for a week and needed someone to fill his pulpit and asked Murdoch Mallison if he would take that honor. Murdoch Mallison was absolutely overjoyed. Everyone would be able to see the quality of the skills that were within him. And so he carefully prepared his sermon after the order of the day, in the style of the day, writing with great flourishes his manuscript. However, the custom of that time was for the clergy to read their sermons from their manuscript. But oh no, Murdoch Mallison was determined that not him. Not him. He was going to deliver this magnificent sermon from memory. So the Sunday came, And Murdoch Mallison dressed himself in the black voluminous robes of the clergyman. And he looked up at the pulpit on the wall and the stairs leading up to it. And oh, he harbored grand illusions of how glorious it would be. So the time came, but he thought, just to be on the safe side, that he would put the manuscript in his pocket just in case. So he climbed the steps and he faced the congregation, and many in the congregation were his very students from school. And he opened his mouth to speak, and it went clear out of his mind. He could remember nothing. So he desperately tried to find his manuscript in the pocket of his robe. And he couldn't find it. So he stood there with his mouth slightly open, and the giggles and the chuckles and the suppressed choked off laughter, you could hear it go like a wave through the congregation. Murdoch Mallison climbed down the steps, his humiliation complete. And he sat on the front bench and waited. And gradually, still chuckling, one by one, the members of the congregation left and the students filed out until he alone was left sitting there. And he wondered what to do. Tomorrow was Monday. He didn't want to go back in that classroom. He did not want to face his students. But he knew that if he didn't, he might as well leave town. However great this humiliation was, to not show up the next day was not something he could do. And so that morning, Murdoch Mallison got up extra early, got down to that classroom, sat at his desk, dreaded the students coming in, but come in they did. And they walked in and they sat, and the morning was complete quiet. No one made a sound. But at lunchtime, suddenly, the door creaked and swung open, and who do you think walked in but little Andrew Truffy? And you could hear his crutch clump, clump, clump as he went straight down the aisle and headed to his teacher's desk, on which he placed an offering of a bouquet of roses and other fresh flowers. And silently, then one by one, each of the students came up and left an offering of love on Murdoch Mallison's desk. And he broke and he wept. That desk, which had been a symbol of retribution and justice and law, became an altar of an offering of love. And what God had already begun doing in Murdoch Mallison was now made complete by the love of God being demonstrated by those students. And Murdoch Mallison changed that day. And the one who had been a terror to children became childlike himself and determined that he would do good to his students, that they would learn good through him. And his theology changed, and his heart changed, and his relationships with his students changed. And the whip was no more. Merciless law exchanged for the perfect love of God.
Micah 6:8. That's the transition I'm believing for the church. We are the church. And the best transition can happen is to break any in us that is a love for justice with some occasional mercy. The scripture says to do justly, but love mercy. And the word that's been coming to me over and over and over again, I'm going to share it. It's been repeated, but I believe that there is a spiritual opportunity in an overwhelming love that we can enter into and make that same kind of transition. Oh, we're not all Murdoch Mallison, but we probably all got a little Murdoch Mallison in us somewhere. Huh? And I believe that that transition is what God is going to bring the church into. And it's going to be the efficacy of the Holy Spirit that really does it. But I just want to, I just believe that we've got to become more love inside minded. That it's almost like we're missing one of the greatest blessings. The great commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and to love one another. And it's almost like the church is known for a lot of things, but love's not one of them. Really, if we're honest, that is the fruit is deficient with all the Bible knowledge and all the giftings. But Romans 5:5 says, hope does not disappoint. Why? Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. We need to recognize it's been given to us. It's Christ in you. It's already been given. A lot of times we're hoping for something when in reality we haven't exercised the capacity and the potential that we have that requires acted on. And I believe too that in some cases ignorance is what's robbed us of God's best. It's not that there's anything lacking in God, but our own ignorance can do it. I like John 17:26, and this is something that we need to all pray for and believe that in the days ahead. John 17:26 is basically Jesus says, I have declared to them your name, and will declare it, that the love with which you love me may be in them and I in them. The same love that the Father had for Jesus, Jesus prayed would be in us. The same love. If we don't allow ignorance to stand in the way, then I think we need to begin to realize that we have everything we need on the inside of us, that we're not deficient. The spirit capacity for faith, hope, and love is tremendous. But it's just like we had Michael up here as a young boy. Well, he has two boys. But those young boys have the same muscles that their father Michael has. The same muscles. The difference is they haven't developed them over time to be as strong as their father. And that is what is lacking. It's not that we don't have the capacity within us. It's that we fail to develop that capacity. And there are practical ways to do this. This is not theoretical pie in the sky. This is basically that the love of God, it can be taught to be developed. That we have a great responsibility for your spirit. And the first time I saw this by revelation was I started my first church in a vacuum cleaner repair building. Vacuum cleaners lined the room and tools and stuff, and had a few chairs set up. And every offering, we would buy another chair, because if you don't have chairs, I mean, people need to sit. And so, God showed me, and I was looking, and I was in my probably early 30s, late 20s or early 30s, and I looked out, and it was like God took a screen and passed it over them, because my thought was they're all older than me. That can, you know, sometimes you get caught up in stuff like that. They're all older than me. And God went like this, and with that screen, he showed me big, big heads, little bitty spirits. He says, speak to the spirit, because it's the spirit where the light, the life, and the love of God get cultivated and developed. Biblical literacy, wonderful. But that spirit needs strengthened and grown and exercised and developed. The capacities there. You have an anointing. It abides within. But you have to act on it and develop it just like you would strengthen a muscle to grow up into him by reason of use. So I saw that we have this great capacity. I want to enter into the fullness of that capacity, and I believe so do you. And the two things about that capacity is that if you don't develop it, there is a consequence. Do you know any biblically literate people that are miserable? But they're biblically literate, but it's not working real well. I'll guarantee you it won't be in the gifting or in the knowledge. It will be in the character. And I'm convinced that the most powerful force on the earth is the love of God. And one of the ways that I think you could even practice it is that the key is to be able to drop down, because there is a river that flows out of your innermost being. If you would practice, even in a hostile environment, releasing the love of God, you would be strengthened by the Spirit in the inner man, because you're exercising it and you're releasing it. And it does flow from the belly, and it is like a supernatural river. This Spirit capacity, though, I want to read 1 Chronicles chapter 16, because here's the phrase that's been repeated again and again and again, and I feel like it's something that needs to be released in the Spirit, and I want us all to release this in the Spirit. As a matter of fact, every time I say it, I want you to say it out loud with me. For he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Let's do it one time just to practice. For he is good, and his mercy endures forever. I believe it's doing something in the heavenlies. I really believe that there's a change and a transformation that's taking place. 1 Chronicles 16 says, "Then the trees of the wood shall rejoice before the Lord, for he's coming to judge the earth. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever." Mercy, compassion, the love of God, these are all interchangeable words, but the love of God is a giver. Now, let me explain giver, because I really believe that we need to practice this to develop this. When you give something, in the world, you can give in order to get, all right? Even unsaved people can love them that love them back. But when you learn to give from the heart, material things, money, affection, attention, whatever, when you release it, you're doing it from the power of God as unto God's obedience. You're not doing it just unto man. And if you're doing it unto man, there is an automatic expectation. You know, one of the ways you can even test yourself to see if you're doing this without knowing it is give and give and give to someone, maybe perhaps over months, over years, what have you, periodically, intermittently, whatever, and then all of a sudden they don't respond and you go, after all I did for you. That means you didn't give it right in the first place. Once you say, after all I did for you, you are demanding something in return. But when you did it unto the Lord, you're sowing into this, you're making a spiritual transaction that's in the invisible realm, and you're giving it, not expecting anything in return, because you're sowing it into kingdom and letting God bring about the supernatural transaction. It's a heavenly bank. It's not something that you just do in order to get back in a selfish way. One of the first things you learn out of that flow of the love of God is that it's not selfish and it's not possessive. One of the most difficult things teaching people even to function from the Spirit was that we'd have to say it over and over and over again, because they were calling it love and I was calling it possessiveness. And we would use Romans 14:4 out of the Living Bible, paraphrased, because Christians do not catch this real quickly. And we would say, "But I love my children." And we would say, "Yes, but they're God's servants, not yours. They belong to him, not to you." Ownership and stewardship gets confused very, very easily. And flesh gets in there. So even your children, moms particularly, they are God's, not yours. They belong to him, not to you. God is able to tell them whether they're right or wrong, and God is able to make them do as they should. And the average mother will say, "Not without my help, they won't." Okay? And you are a manager. You are a steward. You're to raise them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. You're to strengthen their strengths and encourage their strengths, but you're also to admonish them toward their weaknesses so that they don't hurt themselves in the future. That's good parenting. But nonetheless, you never own them, ever, ever. And so at times, especially when your children get into the teenage years, you should prepare in advance that the day's coming shortly, when you don't know exactly when, but shortly they're going to be on their own. Do you want them to stand on their own 2 feet, or do you want them crippled by your control and your possessiveness? That is not love. You'll call it love, but it's not love. First thing you need to learn in the spirit realm is that love releases. Love is like a jubilee. Love lets go, and it doesn't say, after all I did for you. I watched Jennifer's a lot like me in the generosity realm. When she had her apartment broken in, I just loved her response. She was broken in and stole some furniture that was kind of passed down from her mom, and it was very special. You couldn't replace it. She immediately said, God, I release that. I give that to them, but I pray for their salvation. And the time that we had a computer guy come, won't mention no names here, but we had a computer guy come, and when Jennifer works on a computer, she takes her rings off, and she had several rings, and she laid them there by side of the computer. And then all of a sudden, I picked up in my spirit that this guy was really nervous. He kept saying, I want to beat the 4 o'clock traffic in Charlotte, 485, I don't want to, but he was acting like, and went and found out that her rings were gone. He had taken the rings. And she says, one of those was passed down from her mother, and it was precious. And we shared that somewhere, and God supernaturally provided for the loss through people we hardly knew when we were traveling. Some we knew and some we hardly knew, because we were doing traveling ministry. We're all over the New England area. And I like Jennifer's response. She says, what was lost was precious, but what was restored was even more meaningful and more precious, because it came from the heart. Can you understand that? That no matter how precious something is, when you lose it and then it's restored by people who had compassion and just felt prompted, she said, what was lost was precious, what was restored was even more precious. And I believe that we're going to be entering into a season where the love of God is going to show us that there is a way for it to become militant in a redemptive militancy. That the love of God, if it's the most powerful force on the earth, we're going to have to learn how to operate in it, in a sense, in a violent compassion that is going to conquer darkness. And so here again, in laying this out, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. I believe we're doing spiritual warfare in the heavenlies. I believe it's a two-edged sword. It's the high praises of God. And he's doing it. Mercy, compassion, love. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 5, here's another story. And in hearing what Michael was sharing as well is important. In 2 Chronicles 5, 13 and 14, it says, indeed, it came to pass when the trumpeters and the singers were as one, to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord, when they lifted up their voice with trumpets and cymbals and instruments of music and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. That the house, the very house of the Lord, was filled with the cloud, so that the priests could not continue ministering because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house. I've read this, I've preached this, I've seen this hundreds of times, but I never saw the common denominator in all of these scriptures that we're going to get into. The common denominator is they were saying the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. Let's say it one more time. For the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. You know what this was? That was the dedication of Solomon's temple. That was 120 priests. Does that sound familiar? And the glory of God flooded that building to where they could not stand the minister. 120 priests. It was kind of a prelude to the day of Pentecost, with 120 priests were as one, lifting up their voice to the Lord. I wouldn't be a bit surprised if they didn't say the Lord was good and his mercy endures forever at some point in time in that upper room. Because it's the same thing that I didn't quite understand, but 38 years ago, baby Christian, I don't think I was more than 3 or 4 months old in the Lord, the first real supernatural thing that I had was a scripture came off the page into the air. I know people say, oh, that scripture just, you know, leapt off the page. It was just, you know, and I'm going, no, this really came off the page. And it was like in the air. And I read it, and it was in response to a grieving over the people who were so deceived. They were going into the Arizona desert to get on a spaceship, UFO children. This goes back to the 70s. UFO children are getting on a spaceship in the Arizona, a doctor's lawyer. They're getting on a spaceship to go to the Father's kingdom. I'm going, how deluded can you get? And I felt grieved, and I'm going, why isn't everybody a Christian? Of course, I was brand new. I could have said, why wasn't I a Christian sooner? Why did I have to be 20-some years old before I got saved? But all I know is that I was grieved in here going, why isn't everybody a Christian? And the Lord took that verse. There was a living Bible there, and it came off the page. And I believe for such a time as we're in right now, he said, afterward. In other words, after they've exhausted their carnality and their searching, afterward, they shall return to the Lord their God and to the Messiah their King, and they will come trembling and submissive to the Lord. Now, trembling and submissive, you could get a start getting a picture of Murdoch Mallison's God. Trembling and submissive to the Lord and his goodness in the latter days. And actually, one translation says the startling goodness was actually to be startled by his goodness, to submissive, trembling. There's reverential awe. There's a holiness of God. There's no doubt about that. But to be surprised by his goodness? I was surprised by his goodness when I came here without a address, without a phone number, without a job, without knowing what I was doing, and pulled into a parking lot, and a guy rolled down a window and says, you're waiting to get directions, aren't you? Because God's had me sitting in this car saying someone was going to ask me for directions. And then God supplied for $1 a $1,500, $1,200, $1,500 a month condo on the lake in Lake Wiley for $1 because God supernaturally spoke to an absolute stranger to do something for that man. And I would sit on the deck and weep, and there's no better repentance. Somebody can beat you, and you can think you're humbling somebody, which is silly. You can think you're even humbling yourself, but the goodness of God humbled me better than any procedure I've ever seen. I just wept at the goodness of God. And it leads you to a level of repentance to where you want the lordship of Jesus, and that's it. And you don't really care so much about what it looks like or what all is involved. It's like, even if my life is wasted, it was his life to waste. And I believe that with all my heart. Even if my life is wasted, it's his life to waste anyway. Because I belong. And because I belong, you've got a lot to give. And you'll give it no matter how. But it's going to flow out of that belly, out of his goodness. His goodness will teach you that you have a greater capacity for the love of God than you think. He will teach you how to respond in the love of God greater than you think. Mercy, compassion, love. But that's 2 Chronicles 5, that dedication of Solomon's temple. All these years I've read that, talked about how it was similar to the day of Pentecost, how the glory filled the Lord. I never saw that what one of the things they were singing was that for the he is good and his mercy endures forever. And Micah 6:8, it's time we quit that justice thing. If you've got a core value of justice, I understand where you're coming from. As gentle as Jason has been his whole life, I led him to the Lord at 5.5. Gentle as he was his whole life, he's still got a core of justice on the inside that pops up every now and then. He said he didn't remember this situation, but one time he was in church when he was real little, and he came real indignant, and he goes, Dad, do you know there's unsaved children in the Sunday school? And I was like, well, what are we going to do? Put them out back and kick them out? Shoot them? What are we going to do? He was so, that unsaved people had the audacity to be in that Sunday school and they didn't know Jesus. So, does that sound like Christians? Oh, you can go there, all of us. We can all get a little Murdoch Mallison in there. Maybe not with a whip. But I'll tell you what God was basically saying, do justice, love mercy. He wants a tenor of your spirit to reflect the love for mercy. and then show you how to apply it in a violent, militant way that is redemptive. The only violence in the love of God is the ability to be redemptive, because the cross is violent. But it was violent love. And I believe we need to understand that. And we haven't given it the credence. We call soupy love. We call, I love my car, I love my toothpaste, I love my dog. You know, all right, I'm not talking about that kind of love. I'm talking about a more militant type of love that in the face of opposition, you bless them that curse you. Do you do that? I've done it on a regular basis. It's part of my prayer life. And it's not something you try to do. It's something you allow, because that capacity's in there. It's too big for me to do in my flesh. My flesh doesn't want to do something like that anyway. But I can allow my spirit to cultivate, and I bless them that curse me. Pray for them that despitefully use me, say all manner of evil about you. And I want to tell you something. You release that, you're going to build that spiritual muscle, and it's going to get you into places where you're gifting couldn't keep you. For he is good, and his mercy endures forever. And here's what I saw as well. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verses 1 through 3. When Solomon had finished praying, remember this is the dedication of Solomon's temple in 16, but when Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. And the priests could not enter the house because the glory had filled the house. When all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord on the temple, they bowed their faces, never saw this before, they bowed their faces to the ground on the pavement and worshiped and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. I don't know about you, but I want to enter into that at a level beyond my understanding. I know what those words mean, but I want to enter into the goodness of God. I want to be startled by his goodness, but I want to mandate that I am not living in Pollyanna land. I'm also aware that in a hostile world, a hostile environment, and even Pharisaical Christians, and even sheep that bite, because they do have teeth, in case you didn't notice. Even when they bite, that you're basically going to have the capacity to release the love of God. We need to be challenged for her. Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. But we've not been challenged to live that scripture. We've been preached that scripture as a fact. Well, we need to move from fact to reality and action. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. Love and action, peace and joy. If we don't put that love and action, peace and joy, we're not really moving in the spirit realm. We're moving just the way the people in the world do. The spirit realm is love, joy, and peace. It's all the God emotions as the motivation. And so what I'm seeing here is that love moving is God moving. And you could probably take that home and just meditate on that and pull the nectar out of that. But God moving is love moving. What, even the miracles of Jesus flowed on the compassion. Out of that compassion, out of my belly flows rivers of loving water as well as living water, because you can't separate light, life, and love. They're all the character and the nature of God. Remember, he said, I have declared your name. He may as well have said, I have declared your nature to them. And I want to be in them. I want my nature in them. And I want that same love nature that you had for me. I want that love nature in them, that I be in them. Oh, it doesn't get any better than that. Love moving is God moving, and it's a violent choice. So we have a capacity, but we also have a choice. And I'm going back to what God showed me in that original vacuum cleaner building, that we have biblical literate Christians, but skinny, atrophied little spirits. That the emphasis in the days ahead is not going to be like the prophetic has done since the 80s. They've done a good thing. I see, I hear, I hear. I see, I hear. We've got both prophetic camps that hear the word of the Lord, and I see. I only do what I see my Father doing. I only say what I hear my Father saying. But the point that they're missing is that the constant 24/7 presencing the intimate relationship with God. Because if you skip that and you think you've arrived because you see and you hear intermittently, you are missing the main point that he says, there's a voice that's going to come from the church that says, Lord, Lord, Did I not prophesy? Did I not cast out devils? And he said, I didn't know you intimately, because your presencing me spirit to spirit was atrophied, and your giftings and your opinions and God only knows what else ruled over that. But yeah, the gifts and the callings of God are without repentance. So some of you still function, but so what? You function, but I knew you not. That is the great tragedy. So we have to reverse that and say, we've got to get back to the basic command of God that was the preeminent command, that I shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. But listen to this. Here's what's going to happen. He's going to say, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 20, 21. They rose early in the morning and went out in the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went out, Jehoshaphat stood. We've all heard the story of how Jehoshaphat's army went out and sang, right? But look at this. Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in your God, and you shall be established. That means rooted, grounded, strengthened. And believe his prophets, and you shall prosper. Listen to the voice of God, and you will prosper. Verse 21. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed those who should sing to the Lord and who should praise the beauty of holiness. There's the holiness. As they went out before the army, they were saying, praise the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. Isn't that beautiful? That there's something of a two-edged sword. There's something in that statement that depicts the anointing that's in the heart in face of an adversary. This is going to battle, but it is different than any other battle that you can come up with in the natural realm. It's not like the wars of the earth where it's economic and it's people against people. This is a Lord battle. This is a God's battle. This is where you sing the high praises, because when love moves, it doesn't move in the same military fashion. Look what happens. You can read Psalm 49, the high praises of God is like a two-edged sword. God is in their mouth. But 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 22. Now when they began to sing and praise the Lord, the Lord set ambushes against the people of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who had come against Judah, and they were defeated. I love this. They did not have to render evil for evil and fight, in this case, militarily, that the love of God conquered. I believe that that is a picture of the individual Christian, the way you need to go into the marketplace. You need to handle your family. You need to deal more efficiently in the love of God, because it's not that it doesn't work. It's just not been tried. And it builds muscle to the degree that you apply it. It's just like we were saying, Michael's young boy's got the same muscles his father has, but he's not as strong as his father because they've not been used. It's not been tried. It's not been developed. We get back into our intellect and use reason and military might to deal with people, even in the church. And God's saying, no, 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 no. To fight against love. Isn't it true? Love never fails. Isn't it true? Perfect love casts out fear, because fear has what? Torment. I see some of the people that are so busy being right, yet tormented. I'd rather be happy than right. You know, that's a good word for marriages. Husbands, particularly, you want to be happy? Let her be right. Actually, the best marriages, the things that have made us the happiest, is when we both have a green light and we both have a red light and we act accordingly. The area that has to be worked out is if I get a red light and Jennifer's got a green light, or vice versa. You know what that says? You need to spend more time together. Are you talking? Are you loving? Are you listening? Because you need, in the decision-making in a kingdom house, needs to be two green lights, two red lights, or possibly two yellow lights. It says, except yellow light means different to me than Jennifer. Yellow light means caution. To me, yellow means hurry up, because the red's coming. All right, but we'll work that stuff out in time. But to fight against love is to fight against God. Who do you want for you? Huh? If God be for you, who can be against you? But this can't be platitude. This has to be functioning from your spirit. It has to be building spiritual muscle. Now, here's the part that we've taught this in different ways, but I get excited every time I look at it. If the fight against love is to fight against God, then when God tells you to turn the other cheek, unless you've got Murdoch Malleson's God, when God told us to turn the other cheek, he did not expect us to get beat up. Selah. Think on that a while. When God told us to turn the other cheek, he did not expect us to get beat up. He expected, rather, to walk in love so powerfully that when you turn the other cheek, the enemy can't hit you. Did you know that the enemy cannot touch the fruit of the Spirit? He can touch your flesh, but he cannot touch the fruit of the Spirit. He cannot penetrate the fruit of the Spirit. He can't understand it. He can't extinguish it. And 1 John 5:18, if the enemy can't hit me, we know that whoever is born of God does not sin, but he who has been born of God keeps himself, and the wicked one touches him not. I like that. The wicked one touches him not. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. That's the love of God, flowing out of the inside. You submit to God, peace guards your heart and your mind. Peace, love precedes peace. Peace precedes even your perception of life, your discernment. Let love abound yet more and more in all real knowledge, reality knowledge, and discernment. Because your perception is going to be clear when peace guards your heart and your mind. And the love of God precedes peace, so there is an artesian flow, like Holy Ghost fire hydrants. Maybe you start out as a trickle, but even a trickle is greater as he that's in me than he that's in the world, and it will build spiritual muscle. And even submit to God and resist the devil, some people go, I did, and it didn't go away. 2 seconds later, I say, he has to flee. And actually, I don't even care if it's not right away. Because to the degree that you resist with the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, you build spiritual muscle. You actually mature. Biblical maturity, spiritual, not intellectual, spiritual maturity is to the degree that you resist with the Word of God and the Holy Spirit. So submit to God, resist. Jesus was in the wilderness 40 days. Most people would give up by that time and just backslide because they're going, it didn't work, it didn't work. No, submit to God, resist, and you build spiritual muscle. And the love of God never fails. The love of God will win out in the long run. It's just that we've been impatient. And by the way, while you're holding your heart open to God, letting peace guard your heart in a hostile, guess what you are cultivating? Patience. Supernatural patience is developing on the inside of you, not as a concept, but as a fortress of holding the heart open in hostile environments to where you go, I can stay like this forever. I'll outlast any work of the flesh or any demonic activity, because the fruit of the Spirit will outlast the demonic and it will outlast the fruit of the Spirit. That's what you need to go for. So let's get militant about the love of God. And it's a violent choice, but oh boy, the kingdom of God suffers violence, but the violent take it by force. The violent that take it by force are really lovers, lovers of God. And again, to fight against love is to fight against God. So the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. We're not fighting flesh and blood, but principalities and powers. We don't wrestle with flesh and blood. And I just believe that what God is saying, that there's going to be a battle cry, and we're going to lift up our voice in one accord right now, that the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. Every time we say that, there's going to be something supernatural. But I want you to practice, because you may not be accustomed. We've struggled with people just trying to get them to forgive Aunt Eleanor. You know, well, I don't think she deserves that. It has nothing to do with that. It has to do with you can't forgive anyway. Drop down, let Christ the forgiver do it as you yield your will. Humble yourself is to yield your will for the grace of God to do what you can't do anyway. I yield my will to the grace of God to do it, and I release forgiveness, but I'm going to do something more than releasing forgiveness. I'm going to bless them that curse me. I'm going to pray for them that despitefully use me. I'm going to do good to them that hate me. And we're going to just do that at work, do that at home, do that in your prayer time, because any pagan can love them that love them. That's not hard. There's no challenge. There's no spiritual cultivation in that. So, Father, we pray, and we know that you are good, and your mercy endures forever. So, Father, seal this work. Let's lift up our voice in one accord and into the atmosphere to come against In a supernatural way, principalities and powers. We want to come against those things that those works of the flesh, those systems of thinking that would come against us to try to produce a stronghold in our minds. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we lift up our voice and we sing praises to you that you are worthy and that the goodness of God is leading us to a deeper level of repentance than anything we know. But the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. And we're lifting up our voice into the heavenly realm. And now we're going to release love. People have enemies? Do you have any enemies? You have people that speak evil of you? Let's release love to them right now. Father, in the name of the Lord, I release a loving intercession of hard, difficult family members that have caused hurts and wounds. I let the love of God, the Christ the Forgiver on the inside of me, flow like a river of living water. I'm releasing to those relatives, friends, enemies, whatever, bosses at work, co-workers, out of my belly is flowing an artesian river of loving, living, life-giving water. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.